إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله أما بعد. So we're gonna continue from last week. We ended talking about if someone catches a rak'ah from the salat in the time that this counts as that they've caught the prayer. And we said that that's the opinion of everyone except for the Ahnaf, who say that if you catch a rak'ah before the sun sets or before the sun rises, that it wouldn't count that your salat had counted and it would be invalid. And we said that the correct opinion is that if you catch a rak'ah from the salat, whether it's Fajr, Dhuhr, Asr, Maghrib, or Isha, before the time ends, then you've caught the salat and it counts for you. And we quickly went over the issue of catching a rak'ah with the imam, or catching the rukū' with the imam, and whether or not that counts as having caught the jama'ah, or having caught that rak'ah with the jama'ah. But we went over it really quickly, so just add a little bit more just to the discussion. So with regards to if someone enters the masjid, or if they're at home and they're praying with the jama'ah, or whatever the case is, if they catch the jama'ah with the rak'ah or the rukū', so they enter into the salat while the imam is in rukū', or before he stands up from rukū', does this count as them catching that rak'ah, in the sense that if they entered that in the beginning, in the first rak'ah, would that count that they've caught both, or all three, or all four, or would it not count? So there's two opinions on this. The first is that it does count. So if you enter the masjid or you enter the jama'ah with the imam, and he's in rukū', and then you join the rukū', so you missed him standing and you missed him going into rukū', that this would count that you've caught that rak'ah. So if it's the beginning of the salat, it would count as all four, or all three, or both. And this is the opinion of the vast majority of the ulama. So the evidence that they use for this is, or the first evidence that they use is from the hadith of Abu Bakr radiyallahu anhu, أنه انتهى إلى النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم وهو راكع فركع قبل أن يصل إلى الصف فذكر ذلك للنبي صلى الله عليه وسلم فقال زادك الله حرصا ولا تعد. Or that Abu Bakr said that he reached the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam in the salat, when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was performing rukū'. So he made rukū' before he reached the line. So for example, in this masjid, if the imam is there, the jama'ah is there, and then they're in rukū', if someone entered the masjid now and they see that, so they make rukū' before they get to the line, and then they continue walking. So this is what Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu had done. And then after that, he says that he mentioned that to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and then he said, may Allah increase your zeal, or increase your enthusiasm for goodness, but don't repeat it again, or don't do that again. And that's narrated by Al-Bukhârî. So what they say is this hadith shows that, the first thing that it shows is that Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu understood that entering the salat in the rukū' had some sort of benefit to it. Because there's nothing narrated, as we'll see, that any of the Sahaba had ever done anything like that with other than the rukū'. So there's nothing narrated that if they entered the masjid and saw them in sujood, that they would make sujood and then when standing up would walk to the line. Or that if they saw them sitting, they would sit and then walk to the line when they stood up. It's only with regards to rukū'. So rukū' has some sort of special characteristic, or a specific characteristic that makes it different than the other things. Secondly, they say the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam didn't tell him to redo the salat, or to make up that rak'ah, and it's not mentioned that Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu said, and then I made up that rak'ah. So there's nothing that has come to explain it that way. So that's the first thing that they use. And as we said, that hadith is narrated by Al-Bukhârî. The second thing that they use is a hadith from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam that he said, من لم يدرك الركعة فلا يعتد بالسجدة. From Abdullah ibn Mas'ud radiallahu anhu and Ali ibn Abi Talib radiallahu anhu, that both of them had said من لم يدرك الركعة فلا يعتد بالسجدة or فلا يعتد بالسجدة or so meaning that if they said whoever does not catch the rak'ah, and here the rak'ah obviously here it refers to the rukur, because he's juxtaposed them with the sajda, so it has to mean that whoever does not catch the rak'ah or the rukur, then he should not take his sajda into consideration. So meaning that if the person catches the sajda, enters with the imam in sujood, if he didn't do the rukur with the imam, he shouldn't pay any mind or give any weight to the sujood. So it doesn't count as anything, which obviously gives us the understanding that if he does catch that, he would take that into account. Otherwise, there would be no meaning for them specifying it with the rukur. Because if it didn't count, then what would be the point of saying, if you don't catch this, then don't count that, if both of them wouldn't count either way. So obviously, that's the meaning of it. And that's narrated by Tabarani and Al-Kabir and Abd al-Razzaq. So this is the second evidence that they use. So they have the action of the Sahaba during the lifetime of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam not telling him to redo that rak'ah, or no mention that he did so. And then two scholars from the Sahaba, Ali ibn Abi Talib and Abdullah ibn Mas'ud radiallahu anhum, that they gave this special characteristic to the rukur. They also mention another hadith, or a hadith from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, but it's a weak hadith. But the hadith is, إِذَا جِئْتُمْ إِلَى الصَّلَاةِ وَنَحْنُ سُجُودٌ فَاسْجُدُوا وَلَا تَعْتَدُّوهَا شَيْئًا وَمَنْ أَدْرَكَ الرَّكْعَةَ فَقَدْ أَدْرَكَ الصَّلَاةِ Or that, if you come to the salat and we're in prostration, then prostrate and do not consider it anything, and whoever catches the rak'ah has caught the salat. But again, as we said, this hadith is weak. It's narrated by Abu Dawood and Al-Bayhaqi, and it was rejected by Ibn Kathir in his book Irshad al-Faqih, and Al-Azim Abadi in his book Aun al-Ma'bud, and others. And the reason for it is there's a narrator named Yahya ibn Abi Sulaiman who was rejected by Ibn Ma'in and Al-Bukhari and others. So the hadith is not usable, but it's one of the evidences that they use for that topic. Likewise, they use the hadith that we talked about last week about catching the time in the salat, or catching the salat, or catching a rak'ah within the time of the salat. That the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "Man adraka rak'atan min as-salati faqad adraka as-salah." Or that whoever catches a rak'ah from the salat, then he's caught the salat. And that hadith is authentic. However, what's the problem with that usage?
Interpreted as a rak'ah, not a rukua.
Exactly. So it's talking, and then also it's come in the context of the time. Mm-hmm. So whoever catches a rak'ah before the sun sets, there's two problems with that usage. So really, it's not usable. Or I mean, it doesn't seem to be necessary to use it, or that it's not a sound usage of that hadith. So they use that. They also use a hadith from Ata radiallahu anhu, who was from the Tabi'een, that he said, or أنه سمع ابن الزبير على المنبر يقول إذا دخل أحدكم المسجد والناس ركوع فليركع حين يدخل ثم يدب راكعا حتى يدخل الصف فإن ذلك السنة. Or that Ata radiallahu or rahimahullah said that he heard Abdullah ibn Zubair radiallahu anhu on the minbar, and he was saying, if any of you enters the masjid while the people are in rukur, then let him make rukur when he enters, and then let him creep up to the salat, so meaning walk while he's in sujood in rukur, because that is from the sunnah. And then Ata rahimahullah said, and I saw him doing that. So meaning he heard it from Ibn Zubayr, and then he also saw him doing that as well. And then Ibn Juraj said that he saw Ata doing it. So we see that it was done by a Sahabi, and then it was done by the Tabi'een after him. And this hadith, or this narration, is narrated by Al-Tabarani in Al-Awsat, and Ibn Khuzaymah narrated in his Sahih, and Al-Hakim in his Mustadrak. And it was declared authentic according to the conditions of Al-Bukhari and Muslim, declared such by Al-Hakim himself and Shaykh Al-Albani. So here we have another narration from a Sahabi that, again, they're giving Rukur this special characteristic or a certain level of importance that we don't see with anything else. So there's nothing that says from any Sahabi or anything even weak from the Sahaba that they said, if you enter the masjid and seeing them in sujood, make sujood and then get to the line when you can, or sit if they're sitting or anything like that. So it's always about rukur, and there's always or there's no mention of them saying that they should redo that rak'ah. Also, they mention another narration from Abdullah, or from Zayd ibn Wahab, who was from the Tabi'een, that he said, "Kharajtu ma Abdullah," and this is a narration from Abdullah bin Mas'ud, the Sahabi. So he said, "Kharajtu ma Abdullah min darihi ila al-masjid, falamma tawassatna al-masjida, raka' al-imam, fakabbara Abdullah, thumma raka' wa raka'tu ma'ah." Or that he said, "I went out with Abdullah," so meaning Ibn Mas'ud, "from his house to the masjid. And then when we reached the middle of the masjid, the imam performed rukur. So Abdullah," again the Sahabi Abdullah bin Mas'ud, "he made takbir, and then he performed the rukur, and then I performed rukur with him. ثم مشينا راكعين حتى انتهينا إلى الصف حتى رفع القوم رؤوسهم قال فلما قضى الإمام الصلاة قمت وأنا أرى أني لم أدرك فأخذ بيدي عبد الله فأجلسني وقال إنك قد أدركت." Or that then I made rukur with him, and then we walked while in rukur until we reached the line and the people raised their heads. Then he said, "When the imam had finished the salat, I stood up because I was under the belief, or I believed that I needed to make, or that I hadn't caught that rak'ah. So Abdullah grabbed my hand and sat me down, and then he said, 'You had caught it.'" And this is narrated by Ibn Abi Shayba, it was declared sahih by Ibn al-Mulaqqin, and Badr al-Din al-Ayni, and al-Albani. So this is confirmed from him as well. And then also there's a narration from Abdullah bin Umar that he said, "إذا جئت والإمام راكع فوضعت يديك على ركبتيك قبل أن يرفع رأسه فقد أدركت." Or that Abdullah bin Umar radiallahu anhuma said, "If you come to the masjid, or if you arrive when the imam is in rukur, and then you put your hands on your knees before he raises his head, then you have caught it." And that's narrated by Ibn Abi Shayba, and it was declared authentic by Al-Albani as well. So we have from Abdullah bin Mas'ud, we have from Abdullah ibn Umar, and we have from Abdullah ibn Zubair, all of them saying, or all of them giving this precedent or giving this characteristic to rukur. Some of them just mentioning that if you catch it before the imam raises his head, that you've caught it, and others going further, even to the point where they would either they themselves, or they've said that if you enter the masjid, make rukur and then walk to the line in that case. Likewise, there's a weak narration from Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, so we don't need to go into that, but it's also narrated from him as well, and it's narrated from Zayd ibn Thabit, who was also from the Sahaba, that it's narrated from Sahal ibn Hunayf, that he said, or أَنَّهُ رَأَى زَيْدَ بِنْ ثَابِتْ دَخَلَ الْمَسْجِدْ وَالْإِمَامُ رَاكِعْ فَمَشَى حَتَّى أَمْكَنَهُ أَنْ يَصِلَ حَتَّى أَمْكَنَهُ أَنْ يَصِلَ الصَّفِ يَصِلَ إِلَى الصَّفِ وَهُوَ رَاكِعْ كَبَّرَ فَرَكَعَ ثُمَّ دَبَّ وَهُوَ رَاكِعْ حَتَّى وَصَلَ الصَّفِ. Or Zayd ibn Thabit had entered the masjid, and the imam was in rukur. So he walked until it was possible for him to reach the line when he was in rukur. So meaning that, let's say, the imam is a little bit far away, so he made it that he knew that he could make rukur and then reach the line in rukur before the imam stood up. So once he got to that distance into the masjid, he made takbir, entered into rukur, and then walked to the line. Then he creeped up to in rukur until he reached the line. And that's narrated by Al-Bayhaqi, and it was declared authentic by Al-Albani as well. So here we have another example of this being done by the Sahaba. And then lastly, there's also another narration from Abdullah ibn Mas'ud, from Abdullah ibn Tamim, he entered the masjid, and similar as well, but this is a weak narration. So we have the hadith from Abu Bakra, and then we have narrations from Abdullah ibn Mas'ud that's confirmed, Abdullah ibn Zubair, and Abdullah ibn ibn Umar, that's all confirmed, and then we have weak narrations from Abu Bakr. So this is the first opinion. The second opinion is that it's not sufficient. So meaning that you have to actually enter the salat with the imam while he's standing and catch either the Fatiha or say the Fatiha, depending on, you know, an issue that we'll get into later, whether the person who's being led has to say the Fatiha or not. But regardless, according to the second opinion, you have to enter the salat with the imam standing and recite al-Fatiha, or have it recited for you. And this is the opinion of al-Bukhârî and Ibn Khuzaymah and as-Sibghî and as-Subkî and Ibn Hazm. So they say that, or what they say, first of all, that standing, the first standing before Rukû', is an obligation in the Salat. Either an obligation or a Rukn, depending on how we categorize things. So meaning that it can't be something that's left. And they cite the verse when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, وَقُومُوا لِلَّهِ قَانِتِينَ, or and stand up for Allah with humility, or with, how do you translate قَانِتِينَ? Humility or focus or something along these lines. And also they cite the hadith from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam that he said, صَلِّ قَائِمًا فَإِنْ لَمْ تَسْتَطِعْ فَجَالِسًا فَإِنْ لَمْ تَسْتَطِعْ فَعَلَى جَنْبِكَ. Or that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, pray standing up. If you're not able, then sitting. And if you're not able, then on your side. So they say here the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam commanded for the salat to be done standing. And the first part of the salat standing is obviously when you're reciting the Quran. So they say, if you enter in Rukū', you've missed the standing and you've missed the Fatiha, either by yourself reading it or by the Imam reading it on your behalf. So they say this is the first thing. Second, they say that it's come from Abu Hurairah radiallahu anhu, that he said, in adrakta al-qawma Rukū'an lam ta'tad bitilka al-raka'a. Or that he said, if you catch the people while they're in Rukū', then you don't count that raka'a. And that's narrated by al-Bukhari in a book that he has called Juz' fil Qira'ah. Or it was a book that he was specific about recitation in the Salat. So he just had a hadith about that. But this hadith, it's a weak hadith. It's not confirmed from Abu Hurairah, because there's a person in the chain named Ma'qal ibn Malik. And he was declared matruk, or his ahadith are abandoned. So this would be evidence in the sense that it would show that one Sahabi considered this to be the case. So it would lend strength to the idea or the usage of the argument that you have to stand and that you have to recite al-Fatiha. But again, it's not authentic. But what is confirmed from Abu Hurairah is that that he said, لَا يُجْزِئُكَ إِلَّا أَن تُدْرِكَ الْإِمَامَ قَائِمًا, or that it's not sufficient for you except that you catch the imam when he's standing. And this is also narrated by al-Bukhari in the same book, and it was declared hasan by al-Albani. So we have it. What's the difference between this statement of Abu Hurairah and the way the other one was being used? So if Abu Hurairah said it's not sufficient, or it doesn't suffice you except unless you catch the imam while he's standing.
Sorry, what was the first hadith?
The first one was, if you catch the people in Rukū', then don't count that, or don't count the rak'ah.
Well, the first one is about people. Usually the people are following the imam, so there's a chance that the imam is standing mm-hmm. from the Rukū', but still the people are in the Rukū'.
That's one possibility.
Yeah.
The other one is, even those, so those, the people that I mentioned, al-Bukhari and Ibn Khuzaymah and Ibn Hazm, they say, you have to stand, but you also have to catch al-Fatiha. But Abu Hurairah isn't saying that. He's saying, if you catch the imam standing, or the understanding of his words is, if you catch the imam standing, then you count it. So meaning that if the imam finished al-Fatiha, and then finished reciting whatever surah he's reciting, or whatever ayat he's reciting, if you entered right before he was going to make Rukū', according to the statement of Abu Hurairah, he would consider that valid. So it doesn't blend or it doesn't mesh with the opinion or of those who are using it. So really, either we disregard it, or we say it was a third opinion. But to use it as saying that this means that you have to catch the Fatiha and the whole everything, it doesn't actually prove that. On top of the fact that it's a statement of a Sahabi, it's not a marfu' hadith, plus other Sahaba contradicted him. So at that point it becomes not useless, but it's not evidence in and of itself. And it's contradicted by other people at his level as well. So they use this. Likewise, they use the hadith that the Prophet ﷺ, or from Abu Hurairah himself as well, that the Prophet ﷺ said, إِذَا سَمِعْتُمُ الْإِقَامَةِ فَامْشُوا إِلَى الصَّلَاةِ وَعَلَيْكُمْ بِالسَّكِينَةِ وَالْوَقَارِ وَلَا تُسْرِعُوا فَمَا أَدْرَكْتُمْ فَصَلُّوا وَمَا فَاتَكُمْ فَأَتِمُّوا. Or that the Prophet ﷺ said, which means, when you hear the iqamah, proceed to the salat and be calm and solemn and do not rush. Then whatever you catch, pray it, and whatever you miss, then complete it. And this hadith is agreed upon, and this is one of Al-Bukhari's phrasings. So they say that if the person missed this whole, beginning part of the salat, which is the standing and the rukū' and the al-Fatiha, he would have to make that up later on. And you can't just do that. It needs to be contained within a rak'ah. So you've missed part of the rak'ah, so you need to make up that rak'ah. So this is what they say. That hadith is from Imran ibn Husayn that I mentioned earlier, that pray standing, and if you can't, then sitting, and if you can't, then on your side. And it's narrated by Al-Bukhari. And the reason for that hadith is he mentioned that he had something that's called piles, which is kind of an advanced form of hemorrhoids. So he had mentioned that he had this, so he asked the Prophet ﷺ how to pray, and he explained that do it standing, if you can't, then sitting, and if you can't, then on your side. So looking at all of this, what are some of the thoughts that come to mind, before, reaching a conclusion about what's the stronger opinion? Or questions, I guess. Yeah.
Sheikh, I have a quick question. It seems in the hadith of Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, there was a statement that Rasulullah said, do not repeat this.
Right.
On the other hand, we saw Abdullah ibn Zubayr, Abdullah ibn Abbas,
Ibn Mas'ud.
Ibn Mas'ud and Ibn Umar. They're actually telling people to do it and they're doing it.
Right.
So I don't understand this.
So there's a difference of opinion on how to interpret that. So some say that it was clear the Prophet ﷺ was telling him don't do it again, and it's just that the Sahaba they hadn't this information hadn't reached them. So that's one interpretation. So according to that interpretation, no one should ever do that, because if we know the Prophet ﷺ said don't do this again, then we don't do it again, and we say that the Sahaba, it's impossible for us to attribute to them that they would know that hadith and then tell people to do the opposite. So the only logical conclusion to that is that they didn't know it. The other interpretation is that, so it comes down to a bit of the linguistics. So the word Zadakallahu Hirsan wala ta'ud, or and may Allah increase you in enthusiasm, and don't do it again, la ta'ud. One of the other ways that it could be written, depending on how it was passed down, is la ta'du, or don't rush. And that's supported by, there's another narration of the same hadith in Musnad Ahmad, the same hadith, Allah alam if it's authentic though, but it mentions that Abu Bakr said that he had been rushing and then did that to enter the salat. So they say that if the linguistics, it could be written this way. Also, we have a supporting narration of that with Imam Ahmad. So they say that what he was telling him to do was, don't be so hasty to enter the salat, don't rush to the point. And then they say also that the Prophet ﷺ, where he was praying and then he heard a rumbling in the masjid, and then after he said, when you come to the masjid, then be calm and solemn, and whatever you catch, then pray it, and whatever you don't, then make it up. So they say, if we look at all of this, what's more likely is that he was telling him, don't be so hasty to enter don't rush into the salat. And then they say also, because if Abdullah ibn Zubayr on the minbar is saying this is from the sunnah, it's different than him just saying, do things this way. He's attributing it to the Prophet ﷺ. So that's the way, or it's some of the ways that different scholars have tried to reconcile between those.
also read an opinion that it's, يعني قول الصلاة تعود like for him in his case that you know he did this, that you should try to avoid this, but it's not like a nahi mutlaq, like you can't just.
That's one of the ways, yeah.
So if like they would be telling people that if you're in this position, do this, but
don't put yourself in that position
exactly,
to begin with.
Like, I don't know if that's correct.
It's one possibility, yeah. I mean, because it's difficult to see this many of the Sahaba, not just you know, like a Sahabi that met the Prophet ﷺ twice or something. Like if we have Abdullah ibn Umar, who we know his you know, or sorry, not Abdullah ibn Mas'ud, you know, who's you know one of the major scholars of the Sahaba, and then we have it from Ibn Zubayr saying it's from the Sunnah, and then the other Sahaba that we went through, like. It's not likely that none of them knew this, so Allahu a'lam.
So you're going with the opinion that it is allowed to, if we understand it linguistically that way.
Allahu a'lam. I mean, it seems very strong, yeah. And it's hard to argue with that many Sahaba doing it, and then someone attributing it to the Sunnah, and then especially when the Hadith can be interpreted so many other ways.
Okay.
So Allahu a'lam.
So I want to ask you something. Does the hadith, the first one you mentioned, when the person, the Sahabi, entered the Masjid, made the point, walked to the Safa, is that Abu Bakr or Abu Bakra?
Bakra.
Okay.
Yeah. Any other? So leaving the issue of entering the Masjid and making Rukū' and walking, leaving that aside, the issue of catching the Rukū', catching the Rukū' to mean that you caught the Rak'ah, compared to it not counting, what are some thoughts on that?
You know, I think even if you because the second opinion has its very strong merits as well, like yani, the Fatiha being shart or rukn of the salah, whether or not you're ma'mun or not, like
yeah.
It has to be said, there has to be standing. But it sounds like yani, this is like a istithna, like the Prophet ﷺ give an exception to, you know, like, yani, just the same way there's an exception in the opinion that you don't have to read the Fatiha because there's the Imam who reads the Fatiha. So there's, you know,
yeah.
Like it falls logically that way. That
yeah,
you,
if we look at it that way.
The Fatiha, but if you're a ma'mun, then it's permissible for you if you follow that opinion that you don't need to read it.
Right.
And if you're in a state where you come and people are original record, then that also falls off. So it falls logically.
Yeah, because it takes everything into account, other than saying all these Sahaba just didn't know.
Exactly.
Like it's if it was just one Sahabi and then there was others who did opposite, that's an issue. But when it seems like, aside from that statement from Abu Huraira, all the others considered it. So to say, well, it's just kind of random. Like, why not sujood then?
Mm-hmm.
Like there's something to Rukū' that
mm-hmm.
the Sahaba knew, and then if we look at this hadith of Abu Bakr, it adds, strength to. So what's the conclusion?
Before the Imam rises from Rukū', then the first the Rak'ah before Imam rises up and the Prophet sits down.
Yeah. Yeah, that's what I believe as well. I think that's the strongest. Anyone disagree?
I know some people can interpret it like the Imam may come up, but then if people are already in sujood and they tries to really catch it.
What do you mean?
Because you know, as you know, you're mentioning that there's like a lag time.
Yeah,
like,
yeah.
You know, while the Imam is physically coming and you're seeing him coming up.
Yeah, yeah.
But you're like.
Yeah, yeah.
Because like he's too late to say Allahu Sami Allahu Hamida.
Yeah.
So some people just go when they hear Sami Allahu Hamida.
Yeah, so some say if he doesn't finish saying Hamida, if he didn't finish that yet, then you caught it. Sheikh Sulaiman al-Urwan, that's what he explained, because you can't always see the Imam too. So
mm-hmm.
it's a means of guess or estimating, because if he starts saying Allahu liman Hamida after he starts moving, it's not precise, but it's likely that if you caught it before he finished that, you caught it before he stood up, because most people don't stand all the way up and then say it. But again, it's not 100% precise.
But isn't it according to the hadith of Abdullah bin Amr that he said that if you put your hands on your knees before he says that statement?
Before he raises up. Yeah.
When you drop the rak'ah.
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
What if he's halfway?
And if he's halfway, then
he did not say it. It's like halfway. So.
Allahu a'lam, I would count it as long as he's not standing up. If you see him standing up and all the people are still on rukur, then it's too late. And if you can't see and you touch your knees before he says some hamida, I would count it as well. If he's finished that already, then I wouldn't count it.
You know how some of the they would say Allahu Akbar and then they would go into rukur and then walk up to the line.
Yeah.
Would that only be permissible to do if you knew you were going to catch him standing up too?
What do you mean?
If I walked in the masjid and I seen them there in rukur and I said Allahu Akbar, I put my hand on my knees and I walked all the way there, but I know I'm going to miss when they come up. Like by the time I walk up to the line, they're going to be in sujood.
I mean, according to one of the narrations, it seems like that would, you know, it says that he only entered the salat when he knew he could catch them in rukur. Because if you, let's say you enter here and they're in rukur and you join it, if you stand up with them and then walk, it's likely you're going to catch it. But Allah alam, inshallah we'll talk about that more when we get into Salat al-Jama'ah. But yeah, I guess that's a good question.
So just to clarify something, so if you can't see the imam and you entered into rukur and your hands touched your knees before the word hamidah was pronounced by the imam, you caught the rak'ah.
Yeah, yeah.
And if you do see the imam standing up, like he comes all the way up, then he says the full statement.
Then, I mean, he's standing up already.
Then
and we don't have anything, technically there's nothing for that statement.
Yeah.
We have a sahabi saying if it's before he stands up. Mm. But if you can't see him, then you need something to kind of take the place of that.
Yeah.
To be in instead of that, and that's kind of, I guess that's the best thing you could use.
Okay, so that's the...
Because if someone did it according to the sunnah, you start saying Sami Allah after you start moving, so then technically you would finish it at Hamida would finish either as you're standing up or around that area.
Okay.
Right before, right after, but it's not correct to stand up and then do it, or to do it and then stand up. It should be started after you've started moving and finished before you stop moving. That's the sunnah. So if someone did that, I mean it's pretty close, I guess.
So I just use it as an estimation.
Exactly, yeah, yeah.
Supplementary question. Let's say I missed the first rak'ah. The imam is standing now, he's going to go to the sujood, or maybe he went to the sujood. Mm-hmm. I saw some people, they wait until the imam finishes the sujood and stands up.
Yeah.
Thinking that, okay, this does not count. But it does not make any sense to me. I always go and join the prayer the way it is. Is that the correct thing to do?
Yeah, you join when you can. I mean, because the hadith says, when the Prophet ﷺ said, whatever you catch, pray it, and whatever you don't, make it up. So that's clear. And then there's the weak hadith. I mean, it's not usable, but where it says if you come and they're in sujood, then make sujood and don't count it. But again, that's weak. And then some of them also use the hadith where the Prophet ﷺ, where one of the Sahaba said, make du'a, or what I want is to be with you in Jannah. And he said, the Prophet ﷺ said, أَعِنِّي عَلَى نَفْسِكَ بِكَثْرَةِ السُّجُودِ, or make things easy for me, for you, so meaning for that to happen, by making lots of sujood. So some say that this is general. So by entering the salat at that time, you'd be falling under that hadith of doing more sujood. So they use that kind of as a supplementary evidence.
Is this sujood is more about prayers?
Technically it's because we don't just do sujood generally. Like it's for the vast majority of the time, it's connected to a salat. But that general phrasing, by you doing that, you would fall under that hadith because it is literally, it's a sujood. Yeah. So the next issue that the author says is sleeping through or forgetting the prayer. He says, whoever sleeps through or has forgotten to pray a certain prayer should pray it when he wakes up or remembers the prayer. And he quotes the hadith from Abu Qatada radiallahu anhu that he said, ذَكَرُوا لِلنَّبِيِّ صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ نَوْمَهُمْ عَنِ الصَّلَاةِ فَقَالَ إِنَّهُ لَيْسَ فِي النَّوْمِ تَفْرِيطٍ إِنَّمَا التَّفْرِيطُ فِي الْيَقَظَةِ فَإِذَا نَسِيَ أَحَدُكُمْ صَلَاةً أَوْ نَامَ عَنْهَا فَلْيُصَلِّهَا إِذَا ذَكَرَهَا. Or that Abu Qatada radiallahu anhu mentioned, or he said that the people mentioned to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam that they would sleep through a salat, or that they mentioned their sleeping through the salat. So he said, which means indeed there's no negligence in sleep, but negligence occurs while one is awake. If one of you forgets a salat or sleeps through its time, then he should pray it when he remembers it. And then the author says, as to the authenticity of the report, it is recorded by An-Nasa'i and At-Tirmidhi, who said it's sahih. So all to add to this, Ibn al-Arabi declared it sahih in his Sharh of At-Tirmidhi, and Al-Bani also declared it sahih. And there's a little bit difference in the phrasing, but in general that hadith is acceptable. Likewise, there's an authentic narration, or there's one that there's no doubt, and this is the next one that the author mentions, that the Prophet ﷺ said in the hadith of Anas, "Man nasiya salatan falyusalliha idha dhakaraha la kaffarata laha illa dhalik." Or that the Prophet ﷺ said, which means whoever forgets a prayer should pray it when he remembers it, and there's no expiation for it except for that. And that's narrated by Al-Bukhârî and Muslim. So meaning that all you have to do to make up for missing that salat is just pray it when you remember it. So to pray it when you remember it.
Even in the time when you're not supposed to pray?
Yeah, yeah. Because like we had talked about, it was last week, where if whoever catches a rak'ah of the salat and he's before the sun sets, and before sun sets is one of the times that you're not supposed to, there's a nahi on praying in.
So this is like an exception. As well. There's exceptions to that rule.
Yeah, yeah. Inshallah, that'll be the next chapter right after this one, is the times when you shouldn't pray. They also, or then the author mentions the hadith from Imran ibn Husayn radiallahu anhu, that he said, "Sarayna ma Rasulillahi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, falamma kana min akhir al-layl, arrasna falam nastayqidh hatta ayqadhana harr al-shams." Or that he said, "We went out with the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam at night, and when the last portion of the night came, we became tired and fell asleep. And nothing woke us up except for the heat of the sun. فَجَعْلَ الرَّجُلُ مِنَّا يَقُومُ دَهِشًا إِلَىٰ طَهُورِهِ قَالَ فَأَمَرَهُمَ النَّبِيُّ صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمْ أَنْ يَسْكُنُوا حَتَّى ثُمَّ ارْتَحَلْنَا فَسِرْنَا حَتَّى إِذَا ارْتَفَعَتِ الشَّمْسِ تَوَضَّأَ ثُمَّ أَمَرَ بِلَالًا فَأَذَّنَا ثُمَّ صَلَّى الرَّكْعَتَيْنِ قَبْلَ الْفَجْرِ ثُمَّ قَامَ فَصَلَّيْنَا فَقَالُوا يَا رَسُولَ اللَّهِ أَلَا نُعِيدُهَا فِي وَقْتِهَا مِنَ الْغَدِ قَالَ أَيَنْهَاكُمْ رَبُّكُمْ تَبَارَكَ وَتَعَالَى عَنِ الرِّبَا وَيَقْبَلُهُ مِنْكُمْ." Or that Imran, then he said, so once they woke up, he said, some of us tried to rush and make our tahara. So the Prophet ﷺ told everyone to be calm, and then they rode, or they left that area, and they kept going until the sun had risen much further, and then they made wudu. So at that point, the Prophet ﷺ commanded Bilal to make the adhan. Then he prayed the two rak'ahs before the fajr. So meaning after he told Bilal to make the adhan, he prayed the regular two rak'ahs that the Prophet ﷺ would normally pray, so the sunnah of fajr. Then we stood and we prayed. So after that they said, "O Messenger of Allah, should we not repeat it tomorrow in its proper time?" So meaning should we not, like on top of this, again pray it twice in the time, because we missed it in the time, so we should make it up in the time. So the Prophet ﷺ said, "Would your Lord, the Most High, or Tabarak wa Ta'ala, forbid you from interest and then accept it from you?" So meaning that you only owe one salat, you missed it due to sleep, which is an excuse, so you prayed it when you woke up, which is the correct thing to do. There's no reason to then go again and do it twice, because it's only obligatory upon you to do it once to begin with. That's the meaning of it. So this hadith, author says, related by Ahmad and others. So to add to that, it's narrated by Ibn Hibban as well in his Sahih. And it was declared Sahih by Ibn Hazm and Ash-Shawkani, and Badr al-Din al-Ayni said that it's Sahih. Also Ibn Taymiyyah said that it's Jayyid, and Al-Dhahabi called it Salih. So this is an acceptable hadith as well. So it shows a number of things. So first of all, it's evidence that when you sleep through a prayer, you make it up. Also, it's evidence that the prayer is to be done in the exact same manner. So there's we don't not do the adhan if it's out of the time. We don't not do the iqamah. We don't leave the sunnah. It's prayed exactly the same way that it's prayed. It also shows that We don't make it up. We don't do extra salat to make up for the one that was missed for a valid reason. We don't do it twice to make up for it, because we only do what the texts tell us. So if we have evidence to do it when you wake up, when you slept through it, then we do it then. We have evidence to show that we do it once, we don't add to that. So that's the you know, a little bit about that hadith. So just to add a little bit to this issue of sleeping through the salat, or making it up when you sleep through it, or when you forget it. So a hadith also from Anas radiallahu anhu, that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam said, إذا رقد أحدكم عن الصلاة أو غفل عنها فليصلها إذا ذكرها فإن الله يقول أقم الصلاة لذكري. Or that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam said, when if any of you misses the salat due to sleep, or that he was heedless, or he was just unaware, he wasn't paying attention, so forgetfulness, or you know, is forgetfulness, he should pray it when he remembers it, for Allah has said, observe the prayer as a means of remembering me, or when you remember me, or at the point when you remember me. And this is narrated by Muslim. So again, this is very clear that the Prophet ﷺ commanded it to be done. Another thing it shows us, and this is more of a general benefit, is that if a text, whether it's a verse or a hadith, has a certain phrasing that can have numerous meanings, that it takes all of those meanings unless we have evidence to exclude one of them. So because here, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, أَقِمِ الصَّلَاةَ لِذِكْرِي, or establish the prayer as a means of remembering me, what's the first understanding that we get from this? It's that it's a means of remembering Allah. It's talking about, do this to remember me. But also, the phrasing of the verse, li dhikri, can also mean when you remember me. So, like when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, aqimis salata li duluki shams, or establish the salat at the highest point of the, or when the sun is at its highest level. So it can also mean, it can mean do it to remember me and do it when you remember me. So it means both, or can mean both. So we apply it in its meanings unless we have evidence to say, well, no, it actually doesn't apply. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's words are perfect. So when He chooses or says something, we take all of the meanings that it could take unless there's a reason to not take it. So that's more of a general benefit. So, to add a little bit more about this, the sleeping through or forgetting. So if someone sleeps through the salat, or if they forget it, it's obligatory upon them to make that salat up. So they have to do it. It doesn't, you know, like, it's not one of the issues where forgetfulness makes it, you know, it's not obligatory on you to do anymore, you know, you slept through, so you're not held accountable, you're not sinful, but it doesn't cancel out that action needing to be done. And this is, I mean, the evidence is pretty clear, but it's also a matter of consensus. So there's never been any dispute on this. And this consensus was mentioned by Ibn Hazm in Al-Muhallâ and Ibn Taymiyyah in Minhâj as-Sunnah. So the next issue is, when we're doing this, let's say someone, you know, especially now in the winter, you know, they're sick or they're working at night and then they sleep through numerous prayers now. So this is another issue. It can happen in the summer too, but I mean, obviously it's more likely now. So the next issue is it obligatory to pray them in order or not? And this comes up a lot, even with forgetfulness. Someone will say, you know, I came to the masjid and I realized I didn't pray Asr and it's Maghrib now. Well, what do I do? Do I pray Asr and then try to join them? Do I join them as Asr? Do I pray Maghrib and then Asr and then Maghrib again? Do I pray Maghrib and then Asr only? Like, what do I do in this situation? So the issue of praying them in order, when you're making them up, obviously, you know, you have to pray them in the time and then there's an order to that. But let's say you miss a salat and now it's in the time of another salat. Is it obligatory for you to pray that one first and then the next one? Or is it recommended only? So there's a number of opinions on this. So the first is that it's obligatory to pray them in order. So let's say now someone sleeps through Dhuhr and Asr and Maghrib. And then they wake up, according to our time, 6:30. So Maghrib's done. Isha, they still have time. Do they have to pray Dhuhr, Asr, Maghrib, and then Isha? or if they, it turned out that they didn't have enough time to pray them before they went to Isha, could they pray Isha and then pray the other ones, or they have to be done in order? So according to the first opinion, they have to be done in order. So you pray them in order, and that's how it works. And that's the opinion of Al-Layth Ibn Sa'd and Az-Zuhrî and Nakha'î, Rabî'ah, or Rabî'ah al-Ra'i, these are from the Tabi'een, Zufr ibn al-Huthayl, who was from the students of Imam Abu Hanifa. It's also a narration from Ahmad ibn Hanbal. So they say you have to pray them in order. What they use is they say that these salawat were originally prescribed in an order, so now they need to be prayed in order, because that's how it was originally done. Then they also mention a hadith, and the hadith is known for other reasons, but the narration is أن عمر بن الخطاب رضي الله عنه جاء يوم الخندق بعدما غربت الشمس جعل يسب كفار قريش وقال يا رسول الله ما كدت أن أصلي حتى كادت الشمس أن تغرب قال النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم والله ما صليتها. Or that Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu anhu came or arrived to the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam on al-Khandaq, or the battle of the trench, or the battle of the Confederates, depending on the name that we give it. And he said, he began to swear at the kuffar of Quraysh, and he would say, or he said, O Messenger of Allah, I wasn't able to pray until the sun was almost going to set. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, by Allah, I didn't pray it yet. So meaning the sun had set, and the Prophet ﷺ hadn't prayed Maghrib yet. So then he continues and he says, فَنَزَلْنَا مَعَ النَّبِيِّ صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ بَطْحَانَ فَتَوَضَّأْ لِلصَّلَاهِ وَتَوَضَّأْنَا لَهَا فَصَلَّ الْعَصْرَ بَعَدَ أَنْ غَرُبَتَ الشَّمْسِ ثُمَّ صَلَّ الْمَغْرِبِ. Then he said that we went with the Prophet ﷺ to an area, and we made wudu for the salat, he made wudu for the salat, and we made it with him. And then he prayed the asr after the sun had set, and then prayed al-maghrib. So it shows that he still kept the order to the salawat. And there's other narrations of this hadith. Some of them mention dhuhr and asr, and then in all the cases they were prayed in order. So they say if originally they're commanded in a certain order, and here in this situation when they were out of the time, the Prophet ﷺ still prayed them in order, so we have nothing to say that that it can be done out of order. So that's the first opinion. The second opinion is that it doesn't have to be in order. So meaning if you miss a salat, and you know whatever the thing is that you enter the salat, you enter the masjid and it's Isha time, and you haven't prayed Maghrib yet, but the Jama'ah is on, or it's going to start and you don't have enough time, that you can pray the other one first and then make up the other one after. So I mean you can pray Isha and then Maghrib. And that's the opinion of Tawus and Al-Hasan al-Basrî from the Tabi'een, and then from the Imams it was the opinion of Imam al-Shafi'i and Abu Thawr and Dawood ibn Ali. So their argument is, when a salat is commanded in a time, it's commanded in that time. So it belongs to that time. The time is past, it's no longer in its original time. So to say that it needs to be in order now, we're not doing it in its original time, we're making it up, if that makes sense. So to say, well, it also has to be done in this order, needs an extra command, or it needs a text to obligate something else on top of that, because we're still saying it's obligatory to pray, because we have texts saying you have to make it up even if it's out of the time, if it was out of forgetfulness or sleep. But to say it has to be done in order, we don't have evidence for this. That's essentially their argument that they make, and they say we don't have a text in the Quran or the Sunnah or a consensus to say that it's obligatory, so we can't obligate it that way. Likewise, they mention from a narration from Abdullah bin Umar that he said his opinion was, if you come to the masjid and the jama'ah is praying Maghrib or Isha, and you forgot Maghrib, you join the Isha, and then you pray Maghrib after, and you don't have to do Isha again. So they say that this is evidence that his opinion was, he didn't pray Maghrib before Isha, but Isha still counted, and he didn't pray Maghrib before Isha, and Maghrib still counted, if that makes sense. So he held that to be acceptable as well. And the third opinion is that if it's five or less, then you have to do them in order. And if it's more than five, you don't have to do them in order. And that's the opinion of Abu Hanifa, and from, if I remember correctly, Imam Malik as well. What they argue is that it becomes hard to do. So that's the argument for that.
For the ones in order.
Yeah.
What if you have to pray Dhuhr and it's Asr, but in 10 minutes, Maghrib will happen. But if you pray Dhuhr, you'll miss Asr.
In that situation, you do... Well, let's discuss it first. From this evidence, what seems to be the strongest opinion? And why?
The second one.
That it's not obligatory?
No, it's not.
Okay.
As said, there is no text to obligate it.
Right.
We're praying it out of time. So it is obligated for that particular time. The time has passed. We have another prayer right now and it's going on.
So that one's in its time, which is obligatory in its time.
Yeah.
Right, okay.
That's out of its time, so it's out of its order as well.
Right.
And the Rasul says, and he pushed off the Fajr in that hadith. He didn't pray it right. They waited a bit longer and then he prayed it.
Right, so I guess the problem with that usage, though, is they'll say, well, he didn't pray Dhuhr yet. Like, so it's still in order.
Okay.
Like, he still did it before Dhuhr. That's how, what they would say about that, I guess. If that makes sense.
I have the other opinion. I think it is wajib. Like, of course, you know, the thing that makes it much stronger that it's not wajib is we have the opinion of a sahabi, if that is correct narration. Then, they have a better understanding than we do. But, kind of going back to like the wudu and the tartib, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he described it in a certain way. But, in the sunnah and in the salawat, it's also described that way. So, and in the hadith where if you remember it, you should pray it.
Mm-hmm.
And we don't have anything clear for the Nabi as that he did otherwise or said that you can do it and it happened to him.
Right.
What
about the fact if someone said, yes, they're in order, no one doubts that. Fajr, we pray Fajr before Dhuhr, Dhuhr before Asr, and so on. But that's because literally the times come in this order. So if I pray Fajr in its time, which I'm supposed to, I can't pray it after Dhuhr because the time is literally before that.
Okay.
But at this point, it's that time is gone. So it doesn't belong to that time anymore. So for me to say that I have to do it before, even though I'm not in that time that it's originally obligatory on, is like a, it's a ziyada, it's something that we're adding on top of the original obligation.
Sheikh, can I ask you a question, connected question?
Yeah.
That hadith of Umar ibn Khattab that he came on the day of Khandaq.
Yeah.
And they missed Asr and it was Maghrib time.
Yeah.
What did they do after? Did they pray Maghrib first?
Asr first.
So they prayed the Asr first and then Maghrib.
Right. So
during the time of Maghrib.
Yes.
Everyone agrees it should be done first.
Okay.
The issue is, what if I don't?
Mm.
So let's say, now someone enters the masjid and says, oh, I forgot Maghrib. And he says, I'm going to pray Isha because I want to pray Isha for whatever reason. And then I'll pray Maghrib after. Everyone's agreed that he shouldn't choose that. The issue is his Salat valid or not? So that's where it becomes. So even those who say it's allowed to do them out of order say it's better not to because the Prophet ﷺ still did them in order. If that makes sense.
Well, and what if you wanted to do it out of order, but say the Jama'ah started, what would you do? Would you just pray with the knee of that Salah from before then just redo the...
Allah Alam, the best thing, and that's what's narrated from, it's narrated from Ibn Umar, is that you pray with the Imam and then make up the Salat that you missed after. So let's say someone...
Their Salat.
Right, so if now, say, when we were praying, if someone came in and they didn't pray Maghrib yet, according to Ibn Umar, he would pray Isha with the Jama'ah, and then do Maghrib after.
But ideally, it'd be best if you did it in the order.
Right, yeah. But except, though, if he was to choose not to, then he might miss the Jama'ah also.
Yeah.
So he's missed Maghrib in the time, and now he's missed Isha Jama'ah. So that's the, I guess, the argument.
But if they're doing Jama'ah Isha, and you came with the knee of Maghrib, wouldn't you get the reward of praying Jama'ah for Maghrib, since that's your next Salah?
Some say that. I guess the problem is you're not doing what the Imam is doing now. You're intentionally doing something different than him, like you're doing a different salat even. And if there's no need to, like, you know, you can either do exactly what the imam is doing and then make up the salat after because it's not obligatory to do it with him, like then you're not doing anything wrong in the jama'ah then, if that makes sense.
So you're saying that your niyyah shouldn't be different from the niyyah of the imam?
In general, yes. If there's a reason to be different, like for example, you know, we have hadith about, you know, if you pray jama'ah, or if you pray the salat and then you come to the masjid and they're praying, it's you join with them now. So it's nafilah, it's a different niyyah,
yeah.
But we have a hadith for that. But yeah. for this to do Maghrib behind the imam who's doing Isha, we don't have a reason to do it, we don't have a hadith for it, so we should avoid it then.
So what's the first opinion?
To me, I believe the second opinion is strongest, that you don't have to do it in order. Which I think that's what you had just said. That's what I lean towards, that it's better to... But if there's some, you know, if someone did them out of order, I can't say it's haram or invalid. Likewise, especially if there's a reason, like they're going to catch the jama'ah, or, you know, as you mentioned, that if, you know, he missed dhuhr and now asr is almost going to end, if he prays dhuhr and then asr, he's going to miss asr as well. So if it's not obligatory to do, then he might as well catch the asr in the time, then do dhuhr out of the time, because it's already out of the time, and then do maghrib in the time. That's what I find to be the strongest. Yeah.
So it's better to be prayed in order, obviously. But
definitely.
But if you do pray, like you could say you pray Maghrib, then you go back and pray Asr and you missed it, that's a lot, is both of them are still valid.
That's what I believe, yeah. To be the strongest.
Right?
Exactly. Like to say actually like your Salat is invalid, we need a strong text for that. So to say, well, it was haram for you to pray Isha with the Jama'ah because you didn't pray Maghrib yet when you had already missed it for sleep. So then the Isha is invalid because it wasn't in order. It's a very big statement, I guess, which needs, you know, strong evidence, I guess.
What if you didn't miss it for this other shari?
Like you just
missed it because you're, whatever, you're sinful.
And then we're going to get into that, like, about what to do with that or how does that work. So any questions about this part?
I have a question about the sleeping part.
Yeah.
What's it called? When they say when you pray when you remember,
yeah.
Does that mean that you have to pray immediately? Because if it was in Maghrib time and there was like an hour until Isha, I know I can still go drink something and go do a few things. And I would lose merit, but I wouldn't take sin. But if I woke up from my sleep and I know I missed Fajr, for example, and it was past sunrise, would I take sin if I went to do something before I prayed?
You should pray it right away, unless there's a major reason. So like there's other narrations of this hadith where the Prophet ﷺ mentioned that the reason why they were leaving was because it was a bad area to pray in. There was shayateen there. So he left for a reason. So for example, let's say you woke up and it was like, I don't know, I can't think of a reason where you would wake up that there's something bad going on, but... You wake up and all of a sudden, like, you're camping and there's, like, facade all over, which wasn't there the night before. And you're like, well, if I pray here now, you know, like, there's drunk people or whatever the case is. In that case, if you left for a valid reason, inshallah, there would be nothing on you. But if someone was like, well, I already missed Fajr, I'm just going to go back to bed because it's already out of the time, well, no, that would be sinful then.
So it should be immediately.
It should be immediately unless there's a very valid reason for you not to do so. Yeah.
Just about the sleeping, like, with people who have medical illnesses or in comatose state and they're, you know, they miss like 10 days of salah.
Mm-hmm.
they just have to make all that up.
Well, inshallah, we're going to get into that, but I guess the short answer is, if they pass out, or if they go into a state where they, you know, I guess classically what was called majnoon, the correct opinion is, and we'll get into that next week, but they don't have to make anything up. So yeah, let's say that a guy passes in a, he gets in a car accident, he's in a coma for a day or a week or 3 weeks or a month or a year or whatever the case is, they don't have to make any of that up. That's the strongest opinion. But we'll go into all the details next time.
Okay.
So comatose, even if it's not a coma, they faint and then they're asleep through one salat or whatever, they don't have to make that up.
Okay.
It just goes. Yeah, it just goes through.
It's like a woman who has istihadha.
Exactly. With the hayadiyah or the nifas or anything, it's just you don't pray it. And there's no sin on them. But we'll go into all the details, inshallah. So we talked about missing it due to sleep or forgetfulness, and then if someone misses it for a valid reason and now the time is gone, do they have to make it up or not? So next, we'll stop there, but next week we'll go into other times where a person would miss the salat and whether they have to make it up or don't have to make it up. And the things that we'll talk about is intoxication. So if someone passes out from intoxication, or if they're not passed out but they're intoxicated, do they make it up or not? Is it obligatory upon them? If someone is insane or they're psychotic or something along those lines where they don't know what they're doing, in that situation, do they have to make it up or not? If someone passes out or goes into a coma, do they have to make it up or not? If someone leaves it intentionally, just out of laziness or whatever, do they have to make it up or not? And then also we'll talk about what if it's done by the person's own actions. So for example, someone's just like, you know what, I'm in so much pain, I'm going to take whatever, and it's going to make me sleep, and I'm going to miss the salat. Does that make it different than if they just, you know, just passed out? If it's a medically induced coma as opposed to, where he had some decision in it, or whatever the case is, inshallah, we'll talk about those, because that's also obviously an issue. If someone just falls asleep as opposed to if they take a sleeping pill, that could have an effect on the discussion. So inshallah, we'll stop there, and if there's any questions, take those. Wallahu alam.